Welcome, brothers and sisters. I'm Fred Stankus, and the subject for the program is Fred's boat story. And who's Fred? Well, that's me. And the reason why I'm going to tell you about the story, because it has something to do, you could say, with sort of a spiritual journey. MeherBaba, if you are not aware of who he is recognized as the avatar or godman of this age. I have a photograph here of Baba with his most beloved disciple, Mera. MeherBaba was born in 1894, and he lived until 1969. And he was a silent master, and he's been noted for the "Don't worry, be happy" slogan that was so popular with the song last year. But getting to the story, why am I telling you a boat story on a MeherBaba program? Well, it so happens, when I went to India, my first trip in 1971, and also in 72, my second trip, I decided to tell a story of a sailing trip that I had on November 9th, 1968. And I related this to Baba's most beloved disciple, Mera, who would sit on her porch, just something like this, and listen to these stories from various parts of the world. People would come and perhaps tell something about their life, and I just thought that this story would be enjoyable. Well, not only was it enjoyable, it almost, you could say, became a classic. And I'm always asked to repeat this boat story. So what I'm trying to do tonight is to give you this boat story and maybe let you decide how well you like it. It all starts in actually, June of 1968. My friend and I lived in the Manhattan Beach, and we decided to buy a sailboat. So we shopped around, and we got a Columbia fiberglass 22-foot sailboat. We bought it in June on payments through a bank, and we used day sails to train in the Santa Monica Bay just off of the Manhattan Beach coast, and would have a lot of fun. We got brave. We started talking about trips maybe around the world someday, and we started to dream. And so that leads into MeherBaba in some respect, because at this time I just heard of MeherBaba. I never was really that interested per se in his writings or teachings. And one day on one of these training voyages off the Manhattan Beach coast, my friend Bodan said, "Look at this poster. I have a poster here that was dropped into my automobile." He had a convertible, a little Alfa Romeo, and he was parked in Hermosa Beach, and somebody mysteriously dropped this poster in his automobile. And on the back, it had a lot of various writings and sayings. And so what I did is I said, "Let's read this." And I started to read it, and it sort of made sense. And I says, "My, this MeherBaba sounds pretty good, but he claims he's God. And I don't know, I just can't right now bite that or absorb that at that time." So anyway, that was in the back of my mind. Eventually, we became disenchanted with the so-called straight world. I was a store manager with a national tire chain in Westchester, and my friend Bodan was an automobile salesman. We decided to just leave it all and head on the high seas with our newly christened boat called Maya. Now, we've had the boat 4 months. We planned the trip in November of 1968. Don recently gave birth to two beautiful twins, a girl and a boy. So he was somewhat in a dilemma of leaving in that situation. But we talked it over, and we dreamt, and we finally said, "Let's do it." So on November 9, 1968, at King Harbor, Redondo Beach, we decided to set sail. And the sailing started off with not too happy a note. We heard this screeching automobile drive up towards the dock, and we heard this patter of a lady's high heels on the wooden planks, and lo and behold, it was Don's wife. And she had all his belongings and clothes in her arms and just fling them into the boat and said, "Listen, if you're going on this boat trip, you could call our marriage over." And so that's the way we left, sort of like a dog with the tail between the legs. So The day was brilliant. It was an 80-degree November Indian summer day. In fact, it was too brilliant. There was no wind. We left King Harbor, and we had to use our outboard engine. You see, that wasn't too smart because we had very little fuel on board because we expected to sail. So we had to use it, and we were determined to leave at that time and not wait for the winds because of the circumstances that existed. In other words, it was sort of, we better get out of here because the vibes weren't too good. So we got out into the Santa Monica Bay, and we motored for hours. We left at 10:30 in the morning, and finally, about 1:30 in the afternoon, we picked up some winds. So we sailed on, and our destination was the Channel Islands. Of course, we didn't reach the Channel Islands that day due to the lack of wind, and I remember the first night at sea, crossing the shipping lanes. And that was quite a remarkable experience, to see these huge vessels with their running lights going by. Oh yeah, that brings up a point, running lights. You see, we didn't have any running lights. We were actually illegal by Coast Guard standards. We didn't have running lights, we didn't have lifelines. We were basically going by the, well, bare skin of our teeth to get out of town, you could say. So we passed these ships, and it was really a beautiful experience to see. And so that night, we alternated sleeping and taking care of the helm. And in the morning, of course, it was a beautiful day, and we sailed on towards Anacapa Island. That day was a beautiful day with nice breezes, and we on this map, as you'll notice, this is a point doom, the Prisma Point chart. You could say we pick up our sail here. This red line here, or purple line, is the shipping lane separation line. There's an arrow for northbound ships to go on that side and southbound ships to come on this side. So what we did is we took a course here, and we're sailing to Anacapa Island. By the way, our intended destination was Alaska. We were going to sail the 22-foot fiberglass Columbia 22 sailboat to Alaska to then sell the boat, get the funds, and work on the, of course, Alaskan pipeline. This is 1968. So we sailed on to Anacapa Island. And I'll tell you, the sunset was just breathtaking. It was just a beautiful sunset with the wind filling our sails, and the ocean was as still and as peaceful like a glass lake. And we glided along, and there was a little sea otter behind the boat, sort of just going as he followed us with our dinghy in tow. Some of the sights we saw, of course, were dolphins or porpoises, I should say, were just playfully, you know, swimming alongside of us. It was just remarkable. And so we came to Anacapa. It was nightfall on our second night, and we dropped a sea anchor. A sea anchor is merely some kind of an object you could throw into the ocean because the ocean was too deep. Prior to going to sleep that night, I took a compass bearing of 270 degrees, which in nautical terms would be west, a west reading, 270 degrees, and the bearing was made on this big island here, Santa Cruz. That was going to be our next destination the following morning. Well, when we woke up in the morning, it was dense fog. I mean, talk about soup. We could not see a thing. And here we are in this 22-foot sailboat, and it's about probably 5:30, 6 o'clock, first dawn of light. And Bodan and I, Don was his short name, Bodan, of course, was from Ukraine. We talked it over. What are we going to do? We decided to steer the bearing that I took the night before. So through a dense fog, two novice seamen steered a 270-degree bearing. You wouldn't believe what happened. About 2.5 hours later, we came out on the cliffs of Santa Cruz Island, about 3 miles off the coast, and they loomed, looked like the cliffs of Gibraltar. It was an awesome sight, and talk about a great feeling of conquest. We made it, and we made it through by sort of blind compass reading. And we came out, and we went around the island, and then finally, we looked at our chart, similar to this, and we came out onto Chinese Harbor. Chinese Harbor is a cove right in here, and that's where we decided to go in and have some fun on the island, to take a little tour of the island called Santa Cruz, one of the Channel Islands. So we came into Chinese Harbor. We docked about a mile off the, dropped anchor about a mile off the coast. We had a dinghy in tow, so we filled the dinghy up with some food, dry clothes. We wore tennis shoes, which will prove to be a very, very wise decision. And we both boarded the dinghy. We dropped an anchor. We were about a mile off the shore of Santa Cruz Island. So we took the dinghy in. Everything was going fine until we hit the surf of the island. And the surf was turbulent. We were swamped by a wave. The dinghy was overturned. All our belongings went into the water, food, dry clothes, and everything else that we took. So we frantically tried to save what we can. And when we were in the water, the rocky beach really had a lot of jagged rocks and everything else. We were fortunate we had our tennis shoes on. So what we did is we brought the dinghy and all our wet belongings and brought them onto shore and just let them dry. And we said, boy, let's go tour the island and see what we could find. So we walked about a mile into the island, climbed up a few hills, and we found an abandoned Navy, looked like some kind of barracks. It was a Quonset hut, and it had an outdoor basketball court, and it had some outdoor showers where we wanted to know if they were still working. They had a chain that you pulled, so we tried them, and lo and behold, they did work. And so what we did is we took a shower to wipe the wash off the seawater. And so in turn, we then said, my, it's getting late, it's getting cold. It was about 2:30 in the afternoon. Let's go back and try to get back on our dinghy and go back to the sailboat. So what happened was we got back to the shore and we attempted to get back to the boat. But what happened, the surf was so high and so fierce, we couldn't get through the surf. So in turn, we decided who was going to go through the surf. We couldn't pull the dinghy through because we were being constantly washed back. So I was the better swimmer, so I decided to try to swim to the boat, bring the boat in with the outboard engine, throw a line to my buddy who could pull and tow the dinghy through the surf. So what happened is I did that. I got to the boat, and when I swam through the surf, I reached the boat okay, and then I tried to get on to the Columbia 22. Now, this is a fiberglass slick body, and it's not that easy when you weigh about 225 pounds, and I climbed into a dinghy. I didn't have to scale a side of a yacht, so I attempted to scale the side by lifting myself up, and I could not. I started to panic a little bit. I swam around to the anchor chain. I tried to climb the anchor chain maybe like a little monkey. I could not. I desperately tried to again boost myself up over the side. And in the process, the barnacles under the boat ripped open my knees, and my thighs started to bleed. And this clear water just produced this filmy redness of my oozing blood, that I again started to really get hysterical now, because I thought of Jaws. I thought of him lurking somewhere nearby, and that's all I need to be, his late night dinner. And so I really was getting, you could say, in a minor state of shock at that point. And I attempted again to get on the boat, and I couldn't, but lo and behold, thank God, we used the life preservers that we had on our boat as cushions in the cockpit. So I lunged one last time, grabbed a life preserver, put it around my neck, and then I said, what to do now? There was a mysterious fishing trawler in Chinese Harbor about 1 mile from where we were, and this fishing trawler apparently was doing some casting and nets and fishing, whatever he was doing over there. And so I said, that's my only hope. So I started to swim to the fishing trawler. And so as I was swimming, I was extremely cold and suffering probably from minor exposure. And lo and behold, I looked up at the cliffs of Santa Cruz. And there was, to this day, it's the most mysterious thing of our trip, it was a smoke signal. A smoke signal was emanating from the cliffs. There was a bomb fire somebody had lit. I don't know if it was coincidental with my dilemma or what, but the bonfire was being burned approximately in line with the fishing trawler. It seemed like that smoke signal was a cue for this fishing trawler to start engines, and he turned and headed on a course directly for me. And of course he came across me with my orange life preserver on, and he picked me out of the water. And of course, when I got on, I was babbling. I was hysterical. I was just totally saying, my friend is on the shore. He needs help. He needs someone to rescue him. I've left him. I tried to bring the boat, and I recounted the whole story. This was a lone fisherman who was, I guess, the captain, too. This was about a 60-foot trawler. So he got on the radio and called the Coast Guard and told them of the dilemma. And the Coast Guard said, well, have the man, if you can, with the bullhorn, tell him to go to a point right here where it's furthest to where we could probably throw him a line and drag him through. And so we attempted to do that. We started talking on this loudspeaker, and there was no response. So I'm on the boat shivering, and he gave me a cup of coffee, and I'm really worried now about my friend. And lo and behold, we hear an outboard engine puttering alongside through the darkness. By now, it's 6 o'clock at night. It's dark. And we hear a voice yelling, Fred! Fred! It's my friend Bodon. And he apparently swam through the surf and climbed up the anchor chain. He was a man half my size, probably weighed 140 pounds, and he easily made it, and in desperation he swam whether he could or not. And so he came across, and it's a funny feeling to hear somebody ask about your well-being if you're alive or dead, let me tell you. And I sort of laugh about it now because it was a chilling sound when somebody says, hello, hello, he said to the fisherman. He says, have you seen a man? I've lost my friend. I believe he's in the surf. He's in the water. And then, of course, I popped my head out. I says, hi, Don, it's me. And he said, oh, you son of a gun, where have you been? And so we related the story. We thanked the fisherman. And, of course, we were united back on the Maya, our sailboat, which Maya means illusion. So we sailed back to our original point where we threw anchor, and we said, let's rest here for the night. And so we put something on our stove with our sterno, of course, which made us very nauseated, the smell of sterno. So we just heated up some beans or something and had a light supper, and we decided to retire. But lo and behold, the evening tide came in, and the swells were just huge, and our boat began rocking, and we said, well, let's just leave this harbor, let's leave this tide and this back and forth motion, and let's get out to sea. We're here to sail. So the winds mysteriously were just so beautiful at about midnight. We picked up at midnight and decided to sail out of Chinese Harbor across the Santa Barbara Channel. And it was just amazing. The sails were full, and the winds were probably, oh, who knows, 15 to 20, 25 knots, and we sailed just beautifully, a full race sail, both jib and main, totally in their full upright position. And I remember the feeling when we looked up at the heavens. I was at the tiller. My friend Don was inside the galley resting, and I saw the cross where the mast and the halyards would meet at the top and the stars above. And a feeling came over me like as though, you know, I would not trade this experience for anything in the world, no amount of money, no amount of bribery or anything. This was the ultimate in living. It was just truly a memorable experience, and it lives on in my mind today. And so we kept moving with the winds really blowing all night long. Morning came, and the winds still were blowing. And we exchanged stories of how we probably were breaking all sailing records with this Columbia 22 boat. By the way, Columbia apparently does not manufacture fiberglass boats anymore, to my knowledge. But at the time, we felt, my God, we have this boat just going for, right now, it was a total of 12 hours, and then it went on to 16 hours. And then it got towards nightfall, and we are now reaching the point passing these oil platforms. You've probably seen them all when you drive along the Santa Barbara coast towards Gavadia and so forth on towards Morro Bay. But we were passing these oil platforms. Of course, we were on the seaward side, not on the port side. And so, the starboard side, I should say. And it was just really breathtaking, but we kept on going, and then the seas became higher and rougher. We were starting to get white caps and spray that was just totally engulfing our bow and splashing over onto us. We put on wetsuits in order to stay dry. And this brings in Royce's handbook on sailing. This is sort of a good indication of the type of boat that we were on. It was similar to this hand diagram. And we referred to this handbook while we were in the middle of this high wind. We said to ourselves, what do we do now? We didn't have the understanding that when you're in high winds, you take your sails down. That's the way you slow down, and that's the way you can basically keep yourself from being swamped. Well, we didn't have that understanding, and so what we did is we continued to sail at full race position with our sails all the way up. And believe me, that boat was just tilted over to one side, and it was a lot of fun. We started singing 16 Men on a Dead Man's Chest, yo-ho-ho, and a bottle of rum. And we were living a freedom of feeling. I can't explain it. It's like as though you cast your soul to the wind, and you just say, I mean, we were just under the guidance and hand of God himself. We felt we were invincible. We felt we were indestructible. But little did we know how mighty the sea was and where we were headed. So Don, my friend, the better seaman, was at the tiller for about 12 hours straight. Finally, when it was getting dusk that third day, he said to me, Fred, please take the tiller. I'm exhausted. So I took the tiller, and just before he went into the galley, he says, wait, one thing. I didn't have a lifeline on. I better tie a lifeline around you, because you never know. These waves are getting real big. So he tied a rope around me, which was tied to one of our secured positions on the boat. And so he went inside. I was at the tiller maybe for an hour. I was having a great time. The waves were crashing over. But I tried to keep my sails full. And so by doing so, I had to steer an attitude that started bringing me almost parallel to the breaking waves. So what happened is I brought the boat around to a position to where I was almost going through the tube of a wave, which isn't too smart. So what happened is, the next thing I know, I look up and I see a 20-foot wall of water. And I say, oh no, and it crashed right into the boat. The boat went over, and the sails went to the water. I went out of the boat into the ocean. And so lo and behold, I'm in the ocean. And at the moment when I went into the ocean, I don't know if you ever had a flashback of your life, but I at that time did. The boat was up here, I was down here, so I could not see the boat. I was inside the ocean. And so I'm desperately thinking, this is it for me. I have a flashback of my life. I'm starting to think, bye, this must be how death feels, because I started feeling a weightless feeling, totally free of my mind and all my burdens and everything else. And so suddenly, though, about a minute in the water, the boat was righted, and I was brought back into the boat like a cork, just popped out, literally. See what happened? Boat on went over on the other side and stepped on the keel and rocked the boat until it righted, and when it righted, I was brought back into the cockpit of the boat. And so I was yelling to him, help! Help! I can't breathe! Because the rope that he tied around my waist was cutting through my body. So he was a little upset with me, thinking I was panicking. So he slammed me a good one into the mouth. And I says, no, no. And finally, he seen my discoloration. I was turning literally blue. So he unfastened that, and we both had a hearty laugh. But then in turn, we saw the amount of water in the boat. So we used the bilge pump. And then finally, in Royce's book of sailing, we realized one should roller reef the main. And so we dropped the mainsail. Our jib already was torn apart, torn to shreds. And then suddenly, through this stormy night, we came to a point at Point Conception where the northern waters converge with the southern waters, and we entered what is called a whirlpool. And this was awesome. We were in a swirling whirlpool at that time. It was swirling, and our boat was moving around like this, and the phosphorescence of the water was just awesome. So we decided, hey, this could be it. We had a flare gun on board, and we shot off four flares, green, red. We were acknowledged by someone who acknowledged us with a parachute flare. So anyway, we finally battened down the hatches, and that night we spent just drifting at sea. The following 2 days, we also drifted. We were really defeated. We really felt this was it for us. And so finally, on the third day, I got up enough strength to raise up the mainsail, and we sailed in towards the coast, and we came out near Gavadia here. And that's where we met one of those oil rigging boats that took care of these outdoor platforms. And we asked him for some outboard fuel, which he did give us. And in turn, we motored back into Santa Barbara. But motoring into Santa Barbara, we ran into some kelp beds, and we got our engines caught, and we got all tangled up there. And when we got into the Santa Barbara harbor, we went aground on a sandbar and were towed into our slip by the harbor master. Anyway, as it ended up, I called a yacht broker and told him about what happened. He in turn called the bank and reported that we were a couple irresponsible shenanigans with the Columbia 22-foot boat. And when we went shopping in Santa Barbara, the next evening when we came back to the boat slip, the boat was gone. It was picked up and repossessed and put in dry dock. And so we ended up renting a car and driving back to Los Angeles, and Don went back to his wife and I went back to a job in the real world. Well, that's the boat story, and I'm glad I had a chance to tell it. And